So this is a provocative subject, again, exploring racial inequities in healthcare at end of life. Racial and ethnic disparities in healthcare have been well documented among communities of color with respect to access of care, receipt of care, and quality care. As a result of these disparities, communities of color are often diagnosed with late stage illness and have inferior outcomes, likely leading to increased suffering. Is there any question why communities of color typically have major mistrust for the healthcare system? Jessica Zitter is a medical doctor, and she's also degreed as a master's of public health. She practices ICU and palliative care at Highland Hospital, which many of you know as Alameda Health Systems in Oakland, California. Pastor Corey Kennard is president and CEO of CLK Group, Inc. He's the pastor of Amplify Christian Church and faculty lead for Duke University's Institute on Care at End of Life. So Jessica, how did you get the vision for this particular gathering, this particular event?
The jump to racial equity, racial inequities, and being concerned about that, for me was very, very natural, because it's another piece of the injustice of the way we treat people in healthcare. It's one subcompartment of the many unintentional, I think, in a lot of ways, injustices that are done to people who are approaching the ends of their lives. And of course, I've spent most of my career working in communities of color, and as I've done more and more research and seen the horrifying data in African-American communities compared to white communities, and that's unbelievably disturbing to me. So there's major work to be done here.
Pastor Corey.
Yes.
How is it that you've come to be so passionate about this subject of racial inequities and health equity and so on?
Dealing with those things on a consistent basis, and then also hearing from a white physician who actually came to me and said, Pastor Corey, I need your help. And he was citing a very large church in the Detroit area. And he said, many people that are coming from this ministry are not dying well. They're dying, but they're not dying well. We can do more to help them in the process. But he said, I need you to help me so that I can help them. How can they be more trusting of me? How can we provide services that they're not skeptical of? It was really a calling for me to say, hey, I have to do something personally about this.
I want to shift a bit and ask questions as it relates to the barriers. Barriers as it relates to healthcare and end of life and the things that you've seen and heard. What are some of those barriers, and how do you respond to those barriers?
One of the major barriers that patients often feel who are African American are, or is the trust issue, a lack of trust. And it doesn't just start when a person enters into the hospital. Oftentimes, we try to look at it from that standpoint. It's like, I want the patients to trust me, but you're up against what happens every day in a person's life in society. When you can look at situations that have gone on recently, unfortunately, with our police force or police officers around the country, without justice being done, it is a modern day reminder of the fact that maybe the lives of African Americans may not be as valued in the eyesight of our system, so to speak. And so when you enter into the healthcare walls, here's yet another system that I have to deal with. And in this system, I may not get the justice that I desire. So if a Dr. Zitter comes to me and she says to me, there's nothing else I can do for you, she may be very honest in that and may be very truthful in that. But the barrier is, should I believe what she's saying? Is she going to give something more or more effort to someone else who doesn't look like me in another room, but she just wants to tell me that so that she can move on with her life and deal with other patients that are quote unquote, more important to her?
I mean, I can speak to the barriers from my perspective. As a left-leaning, progressive person who absolutely could not imagine referring to myself as a racist, the idea that I would be confronting a patient who might think that I was trying, that I was being racist, that I was trying to withhold something, that I was trying to deprive, to perpetuate this already horrible, you know, series of inequities, is horrifying. And so I can tell you, and in fact, if you've seen the movie Extremist, I'm trying to talk to the daughter of a woman who is not likely to wake up again. And I'm worried that there's been a lot of trauma in this experience that this woman has had and that she's experiencing. And I worry that she's not hearing what I'm telling her about this neurologic prognosis. And she is kind of backing up and feeling like I'm pushing her. I'm trying to liberate this ventilator so I can use it for someone else. And that was, I remember that my gut feeling is to just run away and say, sure, and let's just go ahead and stop the conversation. I can see that I'm upsetting you. Let's put the trach in the peg and let's do it. I stayed with her. She was angry. She was feeling untrusting of me, and I stayed with her. I kept the conversation going. So that's one barrier, which is this fear of looking like you're depriving, looking like you're being racist. And you don't want that. Yeah. And so you will just, okay, let's go ahead and do it.
It takes a lot of courage, though. I mean, don't you think it takes a lot of courage to not say what a person may want to hear, but to, with grace, give them the truth? Can I keep it real, folks? How does a Jewish physician embrace people that don't look like you, come from a totally different social economic background? What is it that drives you to want to be one with people?
I have been taught many things by many people, and Betty has taught me a lot. I feel that I'm open to it, and that has been helpful. But I didn't come into this saying, I know there's a problem. I know that I have implicit bias. I know, you know, I didn't think I had any implicit bias. I thought I was a caregiver. I care about people. I am a progressive, liberal person. I come from a persecuted people as well. I am not somebody who would ever play into a system like that. And it honestly, it takes people pointing stuff like that out. And I would have to thank the people on our palliative care team for that. But so, I mean, sometimes you just really need to listen to the people around you. And I think that's one thing I can do.
Wow. That's a novel issue, listening to people around you.
But there's one more thing. And that is when you listen and then you actually come into a relationship in a way that you may not have actually thought about doing, and you hold hands with people around a bedside and pray. I mean, I'm Jewish. We don't pray around bedsides like that, or at least many of us don't. I'm sure there are some who do. It's not my tradition, but Betty said, no, you know, you're gonna do that right now. And you know what? The first few times, I was really uncomfortable. Mm. And you know what? Now I'm getting more comfortable. And more importantly, it's not just about the act of praying, but it's the feeling I have afterwards, that connection to a person that I've prayed with, and feeling and watching them as they relax and begin to trust me a little bit more. That is just one of the most humanizing feelings. I had a patient I write about in my book called, it's called Miss Mabel. So I guess it was a day or two after she'd been extubated, and I went to her room, and I she is starting to get a little bit more short of breath again. And I felt an urgency to understand what she wanted us to do. And I went into her room and I started to talk to her, and I was trying to do advanced care planning, and what do you think? Would you want to be on this machine again, or would you not want to be? And she's leaning back in the bed away from me. And at that moment, you know Keturah, the social worker.
Yes.
She was a social work intern. This was years ago. And all of a sudden, I noticed, she touches my arm. And I like, she was right behind me. She said, Dr. Sitter, do you mind if I give it a try? And I said, like thinking, what did I say? Was I okay? Was I racially inappropriate? Was I disrespectful? And she moves in front of me and I step back and she looks at her and she says, she didn't touch her. She said, Miss Mabel, your hair looks beautiful. So, and Miss Mabel just relaxed and all of a sudden they started to have this conversation. And then I could come back a few hours later with Keturah and talk to her. But I wouldn't have ever thought to call her Miss Mabel. And I would never have thought to talk to her about her hair. And that was really important.
You have to understand the dynamics that we're talking about here. It's about human beings not feeling respected and honored when they are in a very vulnerable position. And that's what we have to deal with. And if you deal with that, you're gonna deal with the racism issue. You're gonna deal with the judgmental issue. If we get to the point of seeing human beings who are scared, who are vulnerable, and who are dealing with all types of things in life, but then they come into a system where they're fearful, they have no control, they feel like they cannot speak for themselves and make decisions that are empowering. They don't feel like they have the autonomy. And so they're in a position where they're saying, I don't trust what's being said about my loved one. And I'm having a hard time.
Have people on your team, like Betty, who can build bridges for me to get to those patients. Because sometimes I'm not the right person to come in, no matter how well-intentioned I am, no matter how much I reassure, no matter how much, it doesn't matter. What I really need is somebody who can speak the same language. I don't mean it's English, it's all English, but the same meanings and invoke the same trust, the trust that I can't invoke.
Mm. Right.
And I think that's why we need to have diverse healthcare teams, we need to have collaborative healthcare teams, we need to have our chaplains front and center. We need to prioritize that, our social workers, and I think that's what palliative care does beautifully.
Wow. And to be intentionally diverse, I think is the key in terms of what you just said. We have to be intentionally diverse. Why? Because we need to reflect, our staffs need to reflect the populations that we actually serve. Because when we don't do that, we play into the thought or the notion that an African American is not even good enough to serve on your staff. And so if they're not good enough to serve on your staff, then maybe I'm not good enough in your eyes to even be a person that you would go, once again, above and beyond to make sure that they're comfortable and treated well.
Can I tell that the data that I told you this
afternoon? Give me the data.
Study looked at about 200 patients with long bone fractures. I think they were femur fractures. Very painful. And found that 74% of the white patients were treated with pain meds. Only 50% of the African-American patients were treated with pain meds. I mean, that's just a discrepancy that's unacceptable. I mean, and that's all through the medical literature, by the way. There are just scads of research studies that just show this over and over again.
We are clear that the both of you are open-minded and embrace people of various ethnicities. And I heard very clearly, Jessica, your embracing of the team that is diverse and brings different skills. The chaplaincy, the social workers, and so forth. But what about some of your colleagues?
Implicit bias, which has to be acknowledged. It's something that's just, we know, we have many psychology studies that show we all have it. It's part of the, in a way, it's part of the human brain to group people and to make judgments about people just so you can kind of make sense of the world. So if we can accept it, if we can accept it in ourselves, and if we especially, hopefully, can say, I accept that I have it, and I don't want to have it. I don't want to have it. And I think probably most of the people who go into healthcare probably don't want to have biases. I think that we can, and we, again, there were some studies that I looked at that show that you can actually shift people's perceptions by training, by psychological interventions, by empathic exercises, by using story, by enhancing empathy. There are ways to change implicit bias, particularly in people who will recognize it in themselves and who will have a desire to change it. And those having those two criteria is very, very important. So we can change this. We must start putting this into our medical school curriculum, putting this into our nursing school curricula, into our social work curriculum. This has got to be part of the training, is addressing that reality and figuring out how to change it, how to open people up. So that's one very important piece.
There's something to the fact that we do not have enough representation that looks like many of the patients that we serve. I also thought about the statistic that talked about the percentage of African American doctors being at least at equal to or a little less than the percentage of African American doctors in 1901. Mm-hmm. So we have to think about these facts and these statistics. And here's where my driving force is, because every child grows up dreaming, right, of being, you know, and what are the common jobs that people talk about, being a doctor, being a lawyer, you know, being all those. And so when you think about that, what happens to those dreams as children get older when they don't see people who look like them in those particular jobs? Then they have this mental block that essentially says to them, you're not worthy of such a position, or you can't ascend to that level, or you don't want to go to school that many years to try to become, it's too hard for you or people who look like you. But I think that healthcare systems need to be far more intentional about bringing the ideas of people working in healthcare to middle schools and to even elementary schools and to high schools, and to say to them, here's a valuable area or career that you can be involved with. And so that investment, to me, is essential to help to make that difference by sparking that dream again in the young people that are coming up.
Hi, I'm actually applying to medical school right now. As a future medical professional, like, how do y'all take care of yourselves while you're doing this? Because I think especially for African American people coming into this field, when you're trying to bring up issues of race and equity, if you're the only person in the room, it gets really exhausting really quickly. And I'm still pretty young, but I'm already kind of tired.
Unfortunately, many times I find myself in the healthcare field being sometimes the only African American in the room, the only African American at a leadership meeting, the only African American male, you know, in the room. And so it's exhausting. It becomes difficult because you're saying that you feel like you're that token person, so to speak, and then people look at you as the person who has all the answers for the African American race, you know, and all the world problems that African Americans experience. And so and that's exhausting. We have to find ways to connect with people who understand what we're going through, and then bond together with people who are like-minded. But it's also going to take people like Dr. Jessica to talk with colleagues of hers and to push the fact that we do need more African Americans matriculating through the process of becoming, you know, physicians, and how can we get more med school admissions in the African American community. I'm not talking about quotas, I'm talking about giving people an opportunity who are qualified to make that leap and not kill their dream. So we all see color, okay? But the key is, how do we react to what we see? How do we respond? Do we think about all of the negative images that we may see and witness through the media and say, I'm going to approach this person with caution? Do we see as African Americans, individuals who are not African American approaching us and saying, because of historical reasons, I am not going to trust this individual? And too often, we do respond in that way. When you look at individuals, we can spot the differences that we see on the exterior. But at the end of the day, in healthcare and in life, we must approach people as people. And when you take individuals who are patients and you see them as human beings who are ill or sick, and you take people who are physicians and you see them as human beings who have an expertise in a certain area of life and medicine, and then you bring the two together, there's a need and then there's a desire to help. And when you bring those two together, you see human beings who are benefiting from the services of one another just by being human and interacting with each other on a human level. And so it starts with us. People like you and I, we're gonna make a difference in this world, and you have to walk out of here tonight believing that you can by seeing every human being as being valuable. That to me is the key, and that's the reason why we're here tonight.
All right, yes.